All right, could we have everyone take your seats, please? If you see an open seat, please go ahead and take that, even though it may be reserved, because I think everybody that's coming is just about here. And we always promise you, and particularly you high schools, that we'll get you in and out of here on time. And we want to thank you all for coming. So good morning, and welcome to another edition of the Bernie W. Simpkins Seminars for Entrepreneurial Development here at our COCO campus. Please remain seated until the program ends. Just to give you a flavor, we'll end about 12 o'clock, maybe 5 minutes later. But our speaker will speak for about 40, 45 minutes. We'll take a few questions from the audience. If you have a question, please put it on the question cards. We have an usher who will pick those up. He's right here in the suit. And so just raise your hand, and he will come get the cards from you and bring them up to us, and I will feed them to our speaker, and he will respond accordingly. You students at BCC, don't forget to pick up your attendance cards as you leave for credit to your professor to ensure that you were here. And secondly, we ask, please, everyone, and I'll bet you there's not a soul in here without a cell phone, please turn your cell phones off at this time if you haven't already done so. We appreciate that. And after the program, you can greet our speaker in the lobby for a short time. We're on a fairly tight schedule. We want to take him to lunch, and we also have to be at the King Center by 1:30. So we ask your help in that matter. Each spring and fall for the past 9 years, we have recognized national, regional, and local entrepreneurs for their special contributions to the creation of jobs, great products and services, and to the general economy. Last fall, we began our Entrepreneurship Academic Certificate Program with two courses. Next fall, our full program of 25 credit hours will be fully in place. Students will be able to earn an Associate in Applied Science degree at BCC in business with a major in entrepreneurship skills that is transferable to a 4-year college degree. Thank you. I would like to ask at this time that those BCC students participating now in the entrepreneurship courses, along with all present and past Simpkins Scholarship applicants and guest speakers, if you're here, to please stand and be recognized. We have a few of you here. Please stand up. We also, and I'm not sure I know exactly where they are, but we would like to welcome Jason Steele, if he's here. Jason, are you here, or are you coming to the King Center? And Lisa Hart. All right. If I've missed anybody, my apologies. We'd like to thank our series founder, Mr. Bernie Simpkins, for making these events possible through his generosity, and also recognize our college president, Mr. Jim Drake, and our trustees for continuing to support entrepreneurship development and curriculum here at the college. Standing in for Dr. Drake, who is in Tallahassee today on our behalf, is our Vice President, Mr. Jim Ritchie. Today also would not be possible without the efforts of a lot of people, the college entrepreneurship team of faculty and staff, and particularly our newspaper, Florida Today, a very special thanks to Executive Editor Bob Stover. An initial highlight of each seminar is the Entrepreneurial Essay Competition. Mr. Simpkins has established a $1,000 scholarship each spring and fall for the best entrepreneurship idea. This spring, the committee had a tough time trying to pick winners. And so we picked two. The student winners this year for spring are Mrs. Barbara Zakovich and Ms. Xupeng Zhu. Please join in congratulating them as they come forward to receive their awards.
Let me welcome all of you here. Looks like we got a full house, and all of you here are going to get a lot of good information from someone probably young like you, young in heart and spirit, but he's long in experience and ability. So you're in for a real treat. So thank you for coming, and thank you for participating in this, especially you students. Really got a lesson from you. Got a good speaker. My job is to award these two $1,000 checks. They're really not cashable, but you'll have fun with them anyway, because you can trade them in for something that is cashable. This is Xupeng Zhu. She is going to the restaurant business probably on Merritt Island, and she's going to have real chicken dumplings. Is that right? She says, we don't really know how to make good chicken dumplings. So she does. So thanks and congratulations. This is Barbara Zanovich. Barbara, congratulations. It came down to a tie, really, in the committee, and they decided two. And they called me and said, you want to make this two? And I said, what's it going to cost me? He says, well, we'll take care of that. So, Barbara, thanks for participating. Thanks for being a great student you are, and it's great to have you.
Thank you very much.
This is my grandson, oldest grandson, and he's Blake Hunter. And he's not sure, he's surprised. He didn't know I was going to call him up here. But he's already gotten his award. I knew that my daughter and my wife and all of them are going to be saying, well, you didn't recognize Blake. And he's starting a new restaurant in Lakeland. What's it called?
If he doesn't know, then I'm not going to tell him.
Zhang's Rib Shack. So, and that will be open starting next Thursday. It's in Lakeland. What's your address, Blake? All of you have got to go buy some. We got to make him successful somehow. And here's your award.
Oh, thank you so much.
Bunch of ones.
I need these back for the next effort.
Okay.
And you'll get them afterward, okay?
And thank you, Pat, for all you do.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you very much. And thanks and congratulations again, ladies. We would like to, at this time, invite all students to compete for the Fall Award. Applications are available online through the BCC Foundation, and also on your campus, see your provost or entrepreneurship coordinator. Well, let's get down to business. Today's guest lecture is all about what you can do if you will do. At the conclusion of his remarks, Mr. Johnson has agreed to answer a few questions. Once again, if you have a question, write it down on the card, and our ushers will pick those up and bring them up to the stage. You may greet him in the lobby and purchase his book, those that are remaining. A lot of you came early and bought his book already. I'm afraid we're going to run out of books, but you can still get it on Amazon.com and so forth. We are very pleased today to welcome Mr. Cameron Johnson with this short introductory film. Thank you.
I'm Cameron Johnson, and strap in.
Cameron.
Author of You Call the Shots, a man who started 12 companies by the time he was 21.
Not only was Cameron a business owner before the age of 21, he had started 12 businesses.
Earned his first $50,000
before he was 12.
What's going on? What got you into starting this?
Well, I think I realized at an early age I wasn't going to be a professional athlete.
I'm not going to be a singer. I'm going to be a businessman, and I want to be just like Mr. Trump.
While Cameron Johnson may have waited until the age of 9 to start his first computer business, his career really began even sooner than that. It's said that even as a toddler, Cameron had been interested in becoming a businessman, and he was always able to sell any product put in front of him.
Today we're in San Francisco,
the Big Apple,
Los Angeles, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
At the age of 7, he would sell vegetables from his red wagon door to door to neighbors. When he was 9 years old and in the fourth grade, he was the top seller for raffle tickets in his K-12 school, selling several hundred in only a matter of weeks. When he was in the fifth grade, it was wrapping paper the students were selling, and yet again, Cameron was the top seller, and he sold more than twice as much as the runner-up. He received his first computer as a Christmas present from his parents at the age of 9. Only a few months later, he started his first business printing greeting cards, stationery, and invitations for family and friends using his computer and printer. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Cameron Johnson.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's so great to be here with all of you today. As you saw, my name is Cameron Johnson. I'm 25 years old now. I started my first business when I was 9. I was selling Beanie Babies over the internet when I was 12. I would never tell any of my friends that when I was 12, but I can tell you that now. And I made $50,000 that year. A few years later, I started an internet business that was big into online advertising. And we became one of the largest online ad networks, and we had 200,000 customers in 60 countries, and we were featured in lots of newspapers and magazines, and that's always what I did to help promote my businesses. Instead of going out and spending money advertising, I always looked for ways to promote my business for free, such as television programs, newspaper, any media attention that we could get. One, gave us free exposure, but two, it gave my business credibility, because the biggest challenge starting a business as a young person is overcoming your age. But as you saw, I sold tomatoes door to door when I was 5 in my neighborhood, and I sold raffle tickets when I was at, you know, of course, my school, and we're doing a fundraiser. But I really got really interested in business, or I would say serious about business, after I saw the movie Home Alone 2, Lost in New York. Does anyone remember the movie with Macaulay Culkin? Okay, so Macaulay Culkin's in New York City, and he's staying at the Plaza Hotel. So much of the movie takes place at the Plaza. The Plaza is a nice hotel in the city, and Donald Trump owned that hotel. And in the movie, of course, as an 8-year-old kid, I had no idea who Donald Trump was. And in the movie, Donald Trump plays himself, and he comes down and he greets Macaulay Culkin. And so Donald Trump, here he is, introduced to me on this movie as the owner of this nice hotel. And I'm from Roanoke, Virginia, and I've never been to New York City at that time. And so I started begging my parents to take me to New York City. I wanted to go to New York. I wanted to stay at the Plaza. I wanted to be just like Macaulay Culkin, although obviously my parents aren't going to let me do it by myself. So my parents were both business people. My mom's dad started a successful food distribution business. He died when my mom was just a teenager. She later went to college, and she inherited that business, and she grew it to become quite successful, doing a very big food distribution service, and it's now a big division of U.S. Food Service. She sold in the 80s. My dad's side of the family, my great-grandfather started a Ford dealership back in the 1930s, so that's been in our family ever since. So both of my parents are business people, but the way my relationship with my parents, other than being their son, anytime I would ever ask for anything, my parents always made me somehow earn it, and they would always negotiate. Everything was a negotiation. So I begged my parents to take me to New York City. I wasn't going to let up until I was in New York City. So finally, my parents, whether they were annoyed with me asking or whatever the reason, my dad said, if you get straight A's this entire school year, we'll take you to New York City for the weekend next summer. And I said, fair enough. So I got straight A's, because back then in the fourth grade, I could get straight A's. So I brought him my report card, and I knew we were going to be going to New York City, and I was so excited. So then I asked my parents, well, can we stay at the Plaza? Because if you don't ask for it, you're not going to get it. And I said to my parents, I want to stay at the Plaza. I want to be just like Macaulay Culkin in the movie. Can we do that, please? And finally, my parents said, fine, we'll stay at the Plaza. So when I found out the dates that we would be going, I decided to write a letter to Donald Trump. Now, I didn't want to ask my parents for help because I was afraid my parents might say, no, you shouldn't do that, or, you know, I just didn't think, I had learned at a much earlier age that it's easier to ask forgiveness than permission. So I thought I would just write this letter and not tell anybody, just see what happens. So I sat down and I wrote this letter on notebook paper. Dear Mr. Trump, my name's Cameron Johnson. I'm 8 years old. I'm from Roanoke, Virginia. You probably haven't heard of me, obviously. But I just got straight A's and I'm coming to New York for the first time. I'm staying at your hotel. The only thing I want to do while I'm in the city is I want to see the suite where the movie was filmed. I'm already at your hotel. I just want to like open the door and see the suite where Macaulay Culkin and this movie was filmed. That would be really, really cool. Thank you. Sincerely, Cameron Johnson. Now, the only problem is, because I didn't ask my parents for help, I didn't know Mr. Trump's address. So on the letter and on the envelope, the only thing I wrote was Donald Trump, The Plaza Hotel, New York City. I didn't put, you know, a zip code. I didn't put anything else. That's all I wrote. I never told any friends because I didn't want to come to school every day, you know, in the fourth grade and have my friends say, so did you hear back from Mr. Trump? So I never told anyone that I had written this letter. A few weeks goes by, I never hear back. We get on a plane, we go to New York City. My parents and I, we get in a cab and we get to the hotel, the Plaza. My mom gives the receptionist her name to check in. She says, Ann Johnson. They look up the reservation. The receptionist immediately leans over and she said, you must be Cameron. And I immediately knew that they must have gotten my letter. However, my parents are very confused at this point. How do they know our 8-year-old son's name? And I immediately knew. And before my mom could even, you know, say anything, the receptionist said, Mr. Trump received your letter. Now my parents are even more confused. What has Cameron done? What has Cameron said in this letter? And he understands you want to see the suite where the movie was filmed. He's sorry he couldn't meet you personally. But he said, congratulations on the straight A's, and he's arranged for you and your parents to stay in the suite the entire time you're here. So he's a very successful businessman, and Mr. Trump did this simply because I wrote him a letter and I asked for it. In addition to that, he had set me up for a private tour of F.E.O. Schwartz, the big toy store across the street the next morning, and he did all these things simply because I wrote to him and asked for it. So the lesson I took away from that was, I'm never going to ask for anything, and I'm always going to go for whatever it is I want to do. And when I went to F.E.O. Schwartz the next day, there was a place for kids to get business cards made. So Mr. Trump had left me a nice signed note, and he left me a signed business card himself, saying, you know, wish you much success, sincerely, Donald J. Trump. And when I was able to get business cards myself made, I thought that it would be funny if I left him a signed business card. So I'm filling out this form, and you put your name and your address, and of course I just put my parents' address. And then there's a place for you to put a job title. Of course I don't have a job, I don't have a company. I said to my dad, what should I put, like president or CEO? And my dad said, just put entrepreneur. And I said, what's that mean? And he said, entrepreneur, someone that like starts their own business, someone that's creative, someone that comes up with an idea and then actually goes and does something with it. And I said, that sounds good, how do you spell it? And he told me how to spell it, and I put entrepreneur on it. I left Mr. Trump a thank you note and a signed business card, and I said, keep watching because I want to be the next Trump. I want to be just like you. And I don't know why I said that, but anyhow, I come back home, and now there's obviously a lot of pressure. But months go by, and I got a computer and a printer. All of my friends either had older siblings who had a computer and a printer for their schoolwork. You know, they're in middle school or high school and they needed it to type papers, et cetera. Or their parents had a computer in their household because their parents needed it for work. Well, my parents didn't use a computer for their work and I didn't have an older sibling, so I was one of the last people to have a computer in my house. And what I immediately started doing was I felt like I was playing catch up, so I wanted to learn everything I could learn. And with my computer came this very, very, very simple software called Print Shop Deluxe. And Print Shop Deluxe lets you print greeting cards, stationery, business cards, whatever you want from your home printer. So I was just playing around with it one afternoon. I came downstairs and I said, hey mom, check this out. And it was just a, you know, sample invitation that I'd made up. My mom looked at it and she said, well, that's great. You can print the invitations for the holiday party your dad and I are having in a few weeks. And I just said, sure, if you pay me. So that's how my business got started. You gotta ask for the sale. If you don't ask for it, like I said, you won't get it. My mom and she paid me $15 and I printed up 50 invitations, and on the back of all those invitations, just like Hallmark would do, it said printed by Cameron Johnson, you know, and my parents' address. So of course everyone knew that the Johnson's little boy printed these invitations, and that led to a few more sales. And now I basically have my small business. And over the next few months, word got out among family, friends, and relatives, and my neighbors, and I started this business, and I started making several thousand dollars, and I started saving the money, and I started, buying a new computer, buying a better printer. I had all my expenses. I was growing my business. Then came the time for our local newspaper to write a newspaper story about my business, and at the end of the interview, the paper said, you know, we'd be happy to print your phone number if you'd like, because maybe that'll help you get more business. And I'm so worried, because I said, well, I can't give you my phone number, because what if my parents answer the phone? You know, what if my little sister answers the phone? That would be so unprofessional. Of course, everyone that reads the story know they're calling a 9-year-old kid. So I really didn't have to be worried about that. But I always wanted to, you know, grow my business, and I wanted it to be a real business. So, for instance, when my customers had to write checks to my parents and my parents had to give me cash, I begged my parents to set me up with a checking account. You know, and when I asked for something, I would never let up until my parents didn't have any option but to help me set up a checking account. So I remember my mom, we went to the bank, and, you know, one bank said, well, I'm sorry, he's 9 years old. We can't help him get a checking account. And my mom, at this point, she now has buy-in, and she's the same type of person. She's not going to take no for an answer. So she said, that's fine. We'll find a bank that will. And we went right across the street to their competitor, and they said, no problem. And I've had a checking account since I was 9 years old. I've managed my money since I was 9 years old. My customers have been able to write checks to me since I was 9 years old. And that's sort of how I got started in my business. But back to the phone number situation, I was so worried. I went to my parents, and I said, Mom, I need my own phone line. I was like, I can't give out our number, because what if my little sister Claire answers, or what if one of you answer? That would be so unprofessional. So finally, my parents said, we'll help you get a phone line if you want to pay the bill every month. And I said, well, how much is it? And they said, it'd be $50. And I said, okay, I'll pay you $50 a month. I'll have my own phone number. And what I did was I went out and I bought an answering machine so that if you called the number anytime during the hours of 8 a.m. or 3 p.m., of course, I was in school, but the answering machine would say, hi, you've reached Tears and Tears Printing Company. I'm so sorry we can't answer your call right now. We're probably busy assisting another customer. But leave your name and number, and I'll call you back. And so I now had my own phone number. I had my own checking account. I was off to the races. I was buying new equipment, buying computer, printer. You know, I was growing this little business. And a few years went by, and I'd saved up several thousand dollars. And it was becoming really frustrating to have to, like, go and sell greeting cards and make $5 or $10 or $15, you know, per order. I wanted to be able to make more money because I didn't want to have to spend so much time doing it. So what I had seen and what I had heard about at school was that Beanie Babies were very, very popular. And I went in my sister's room, and I was now 11 years old, and she's 6 years younger than me, so she was 5. And I'm in my sister Claire's room, and Claire's got this collection of Beanie Babies, and she has 25 or 30 Beanie Babies, and I know that these things are worth money, and I'm trying to negotiate to buy them from her so that I can sell them. And I said, Claire, what if I gave you $100 for your Beanie Babies? And of course, $100 to a 5-year-old is a lot of money. I told her she can buy whatever she wants, so she probably thought it was $1 million. And she finally agreed. I bought her Beanie Baby collection for $100. There was this new website. This was 1995. There was this new website that had just started, and it was called eBay. And I put them on eBay, and 5 days later, I sold her collection for $1,000. So I was happy to get $900. She was happy to get $100. I thought it was a win-win situation. So I made $900 instantly on Beanie Babies in 5 days. So I never wanted to be involved in the printing business ever again, because to make $900 printing greeting cards and stationery, and the amount of time and paper and the amount of work that was involved, it's much easier to just sell Beanie Babies. So now I've got two options. I can get Claire to go to my parents and ask for more Beanie Babies, and I would just buy them from her because my parents still hadn't caught on that I had already sold her other collection. But ultimately, I knew that, one, I wouldn't be able to get enough Beanie Babies, and two, eventually that's going to dry up because my parents will catch on. So what I decided to do was, because now that I had the internet, so unlike the time when I wrote the letter to Donald Trump, I went on the internet, I looked up the manufacturer of Beanie Babies. I had never really typed up a professional letter and written it to anyone, so I typed in a Yahoo search engine, sample professional letter. Letter comes up, a sample, you know, I typed my address, I put their address, typed to whom it may concern, And what I was doing was I was writing a letter to TY, the manufacturer of Beanie Babies, because I wanted to be a retailer. So I said, my name's Cameron Johnson. I'm the president of Cheers and Tears Printing Company. That's true. I didn't tell him I was 11. although my justification for that at the time was, you know, if I was 35, I wouldn't be telling him I'm 35. So why do they need to know I'm 11? My check's as good as the next guy's. So I said, my name's Cameron Johnson. I'm the president of Cheers and Tears Printing Company. Please send us more information about buying your Beanie Babies wholesale and selling them over the internet. Well, 2 weeks later, they basically just sent back an order form. And I can now buy Beanie Babies wholesale for $2.50 a piece. And I remember the first order, the minimum order was 1,000 Beanie Babies. So I was instantly going to have to write a check for $2,500, which was almost my life savings at the time. And I was going to have to write a check for $2,500. And I had already been through the stages where every month when my bank statement would come in the mail, I would remind my parents that it's illegal for them to open my mail. So they probably didn't know that I had saved up a few thousand dollars. You know, like I said, it's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission. So I didn't really ask them if I could order 1,000 Beanie Babies because it's my money. Why do I need to ask them? So I fill out the order form. I place an order for 1,000 Beanie Babies, you know, the 1,000 that I chose so carefully because I thought they would bring the most money. I mail the order form. My biggest fear, though, was that they would arrive while I was in school and my mom wouldn't know what I've done because I haven't told her. And, well, sure enough, that happened. I came home one day, and my mom said, what did you order? And I said, 1,000 Beanie Babies. Why? And she said, why would you order 1,000 Beanie Babies? And I said, well, I'm going to sell them. And she still didn't know that I had sold Claire's collection. So that's when I had to come clean and said, Mom, look, I've already checked out the numbers. I sold Claire's collection, but I paid her for it, so it was fair. She made a deal. I made a deal. I didn't tell her I made $900. it's a pretty good return on my sister. she didn't need to know that, and need to know basis. And I got the 1,000 Beanie Babies. I listed them on the internet. I sold them in just a few weeks' time. I instantly doubled my money. So then I did it again, and I ordered 2,000, and then I ordered 3,000, 4,000, and then it got to the point where I had 5,000 Beanie Babies. It takes up a lot of space. 5,000 Beanie Babies in my parents' basement, and my dad at this point he said, Cameron, you know, we let you stay here because you're our son. You don't get to just run a free business with free overhead out of our house. You're going to start paying bills. And I said, well, what do you mean? And he said, you're going to pay rent for that closet in the basement you're using. And no one's ever used this closet ever before. But now all of a sudden I have to pay $75 a month rent for this closet. So I didn't mind. I never complained. And what I would do is every day after school, I would come home. I would change into my soccer cleats. I played soccer for 13 years. I played throughout high school. On my way to soccer practice, my mom would have to drive me to the post office. I would run in, and I would pay to ship all the Beanie Baby orders that came in the day before. And then I'd go off to soccer practice. And then that night, after practice, I would box all the orders for the next day. So I would repeat the process all the time. Never told any of my friends that I was doing this. I did this for about a year. And at the end of a year of going to the post office every single day, of every single person in our neighborhood knowing when not to go to the post office because I would be there with 40 orders and the line would go out the door, at the end of this time, I decided I don't like selling Beanie Babies anymore. The money's fine, but I'm about to go into middle school, and if I'm in the sixth grade and an eighth grader finds out that I sell Beanie Babies, we're just not starting off on a good foot. So I closed the Beanie Baby business. I was sick of the post office. I was sick of stocking 5,000 Beanie Babies. You know, 5,000 Beanie Babies at $2.50 a piece, I've got over $10,000 in cash tied up of my money in the basement at any given time. So I had made a substantial amount of money selling Beanie Babies. That year, I had made $50,000 selling Beanie Babies as a 12-year-old kid. Now, my parents never knew any of this because I had my business was incorporated and I had an attorney, but... It's true. But my parents never knew. They knew that I was mailing a lot of Beanie Babies, but they didn't necessarily know what kind of profit margin I had. And, you know, finally, the next Christmas, my parents at Christmas time, they gave me, my parents are very big on financial literacy. So when my mom's dad died when she was a teenager, her mom started teaching her how to manage her finances and to have a checking account because she said to my mom, you know, it was just the two of them. My mom didn't have any siblings. They said, there's no one that's ever going to teach you how to manage your checkbook. You're not going to learn it in school. You're not going to learn it, you know, at home in a lot of cases. So if you don't, you're not necessarily going to learn it in college. So it's very important to learn financial literacy. And that was always something that my parents thought was really important for me. So for Christmas, inside my Christmas stocking, they put three stock certificates. And all they had done was they went and bought one share of three companies that I knew. So CSX Railroad, Marriott Hotels, and Toys R Us. You know, each of these were like $20 stocks, so it only cost them about $60. But that lesson instantly got me following the stock market. And after my little run-in with Donald Trump when I was eight, the immediate thing that I did when I was nine and when I got back was I read, you know, Donald Trump's first book, Art of the Deal. And then I started looking up to Michael Dell and Richard Branson and Bill Gates, and I started reading all their books. And I started reading any book I could on a successful business person, because I don't want to wait and learn about it later, you know, whether it be in college or whether it be in the real world. I want to learn everything I can now, because I want to have the advantage over my classmates. I want to have the advantage over, you know, the guy sitting on my left and the guy sitting on my right. So I had read all these books. I had learned so much about how they started their businesses. I had the successful Beanie Baby business. I had my own checking account. I now had these stock certificates. So when I got introduced to the stock market, I started reading, you know, everything Warren Buffett had ever been written or anything that had ever been written about him. And Warren Buffett always says, buy what you know. And I said immediately, after, you know, following CSX stock, Marriott stock, and Toys R Us stock for a few months, the stock price has never changed. And I said, this is very boring. I need to sell these. Warren Buffett says I should buy what I know. Well, I've already read Michael Dell's book. I know Dell Computer very well, and they're doing very well. So I sold those three stocks, which was only, you know, less than $100. And then I went to my mom and said, Mom, I want to meet with a stockbroker so I can buy some stock. And she said, well, Cameron, no one's going to meet with you over $60 in stock. I said, no, I've got some savings I want to invest. And she said, well, what do you mean? And I said, well, you know, some of the profit from the Beanie Babies. And she was still under the impression that I was making, you know, a few thousand dollars like the printing business. And I was like, Mom, I have like $50,000 I'd like to invest. And she said, what? She was, you know, a little, she didn't believe me, so I had to show her a statement. And, you know, so finally I started buying Dell computer stock. And over the next 4 or 5 years, Dell stock split 6 times. And that investment grew quite a bit, quite substantially. So then I started diversifying and investing in other stocks. But after the Beanie Baby business, I wanted to create a virtual company. So I wanted to create a company where I don't have to tie up cash and inventory, where I don't have to go to the post office to ship things, where basically I create a company and we make money on advertising. So I started reading Business Week magazine as a kid, and online advertising was growing by leaps and bounds. So you take any Fortune 500 company, they knew that they needed to be advertising online. They knew that they had to be doing it, but they didn't know how, and they didn't know where to start. So I created a company, and all my friends had AOL screen names. So I'm sure many of you in the room today still probably use Instant Messenger. But anytime you gave out your AOL screen name as a kid, it instantly would tell anyone whether you were online. It would give them access to your profile so they could see your age. They could see that, you know, you like sports. They could see you whatever. They could find out personal information about you, which is not very safe for a 12, 13, or 14-year-old. So I created an email service called MyEasyMail. And MyEasyMail.com, what we would do is you could get your free email address, so Cameron@MyEasyMail.com, and anytime you gave out that address, it would forward the email instantly to your AOL address without the sender knowing. Meanwhile, we made money on advertising, and companies paid us to advertise on our website. I should say that even though my 12 internet companies were all online, I don't know how to design a website. I don't know how to program. I'm no computer guy. I can't, you know, take apart a computer. I can't do anything. Only thing I can do is I can type really fast, I can use Gmail for my email, and I can use Microsoft Word, you know, to write letters. That's literally all I can do on a computer. I've never had any formal training, so everything that I know on a computer is only what I've taught myself, and meanwhile, I've always just been able to surround myself with people that are much smarter than I am, and I may come up with the idea, and we'll partner together, and I've always been able to find people that complement my skills. So for my EasyMail, I was 13 going on 14, and I had never hired anyone before. So my biggest concern was I was going to be taken advantage of because I'm a young kid. But the best part about the internet is that it's an equal playing field. So it doesn't matter if you're here in Florida or if you're in Roanoke, Virginia, or if you're in New York City, or if you're 20 years old or if you're 50 years old, the internet is an equal playing field because, you know, it doesn't matter. Nothing matters. So I found a guy that could do what I needed, set up this email forwarding program. He was in Missouri. He told me he was going to charge $1,000. I felt like that was fair. I was going to have to pay him 50% up front, when he started the project, and I was going to have to pay him the final 50% when he finished. It was that simple. Mailed him a check for $2,000. He builds my easy mail. I mailed him a check for another $2,000. That was it. So when I went to launch the company, I said, well, how can I get media attention just like I did in that Roanoke Times story a few years prior? Well, I need to put out a press release. So I went online and I said, how do you type a press release? So I found out how to type a press release. You need an attractive headline. So I put 13-year-old launches revolutionary new email service for free. Then in the body of the press release, we put all the information. It instantly got picked up by, you know, several big newspapers around the country. The company grew to have 20,000 customers. But remember, 20,000 isn't, one, it's not very many. And 20,000, two, they're not paying us anything. So we only made money on the advertising. But at the same time, 20,000 customers was enough for me to make the same amount of money that I was making from the Beanie Babies without having to do any work. So now I just go to my P.O. box and I just get checks in the mail and I deposit them. And it was much easier than having to fool with Beanie Babies or having to ship them or anything else. But now my biggest challenge is how can I grow this business? How can I make it much, much bigger? So I partnered with another really successful entrepreneur, and my idea was, what if we could create a software program that could send anyone that's surfing the internet targeted advertisements? So let's take, for instance, anyone in this room would come onto our website, they would download our software program. While you're surfing the internet, if you go to, let's say, barnesandnoble.com, we could instantly send you an amazon.com advertisement that would say, hey, wait, before you buy this book at Barnes & Noble, it's cheaper at amazon.com. So amazon.com is willing to pay a very, very, very high premium because that's as much targeted advertising as you could ever get. You're basically advertising to a customer that's already predisposed to your competitor and they're about to purchase from your competitor. So now the question is, why would anyone in this room download anything like that? Well, what we did was we paid you a percentage of that ad revenue. So you would just surf the web the same way you normally would. This ad bar would sit at the top of your screen and it would send you targeted advertisements. We shared 70% of the revenue with all of our members. We also gave you 10% of what all of your friends earned. So if one person in this room tells everyone, either through Facebook or Twitter or whatever else, to go sign up, we give you 10% of what everyone in this room earns. And meanwhile, we're going to pay you. So on average, our customer would earn about $20 a month from our service. Now, advertisers were paying us, obviously, much more than that. So we grew, and we were featured in the cover of Business Week magazine when I was 15, and I was the CEO of this company, and we had never taken any outside investment. And we grew in our first 6 months to have 200,000 customers in 60 countries. We were displaying 15 million advertisements per day. So 15 million ads were rotating throughout our network per day, and that was generating $15,000 per day in revenue. So here I was in the ninth grade, and I'm getting checks in the mail for $100,000 a week. Now, remember, we're paying out a percentage of that, but at the same time, our business model is 100% profitable because we only pay out a percentage of that. And our expenses are so low because it's myself, another young entrepreneur in Ohio, and another one in California, and we all three partnered together, and we developed this company, and we ended up growing it to be quite successful, and we made quite a substantial amount of money from it. And we ended up selling the company and walking away. And the reason why we sold the assets of the company and we didn't sell the entire company was because we have built this company sort of attached to our names. And if a new company came in and they started instantly, whether it be spamming our 200,000 customers or selling their customers' information, is you gotta remember, we were mailing these people real checks. And what that means is we had everyone's social security number, because if you made over $600 a year from our service, we had to 1099 you and send you, report it to the IRS. And so we had a lot of personal information on all of our people. So we decided to destroy the customer data and to sell the company for much less money, because we basically knew that we can always go and make more money, yet we can't necessarily go and fix our reputation overnight. So that was our thoughts. My two partners were going off to college, Harvard, and one went to Stanford. Meanwhile, I then started, after we sold that company, I started working for my father's Ford dealership, and I came in and I was involved in the internet department. And at the heart of entrepreneurship, entrepreneurs are just problem solvers. We either see a problem and we figure out a way to fix it, either we see a business and we figure out, hey, we can do that same business better, so we're gonna be a competitor to them, or we have a problem in our own lives and we go and solve it. Entrepreneurs at the very heart are just problem solvers. And if you can figure out problems, then you're an entrepreneur if you act on it. And so when I talk about in my book, the first chapter I think is the most important, and it's titled, Put Yourself Out There. If you have all the education in the world and all the connections in the world, and you don't do anything with it, then it doesn't matter. You've got to put yourself out there. You've got to reach out to people, just like I did when I was, you know, had Donald Trump not responded in the way he did, would that have had a different impact on me? I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. But you've got to go for it. And a good friend of mine wrote a big best-selling book last year called The 4-Hour Workweek. And Tim Ferriss wrote this book, and he was guest lecturing at Princeton. And, I mean, those are some pretty smart students. I wouldn't get accepted there. And he's guest lecturing at Princeton to an audience of about 200. And he challenged them, and he says, by next week's class, I want everyone in the class to go, if you want to, this is optional, go and try and reach out to someone who you don't think is accessible. It can be a CEO of a company, it can be a politician, it can be a celebrity. Whoever you want to reach out to, the first one of you that gets a response and brings it to me, I'll pay for you to go anywhere in the world. So that's the challenge. So celebrity, CEO, or a politician, all you gotta do is write them a letter, even tell them what you're doing. I'm in this class and I'm supposed to write to someone successful, and if I get a response, then you know I get extra credit. So he comes in the next week and he asks a show of hands of how many people got a response. Not one hand goes up. Okay, so then he asks the question, how many of you wrote the letter? Not one person even took the time to write the letter. So we have this like preconceived notion, I guess, that people, they're not willing to help us, or they're not accessible, or you know, and that's the exact opposite, and that's especially the exact opposite of what the internet's created. I mean, you know, when you've got over 300 million people on Facebook, you can pretty much get access to just about anyone. Same goes for LinkedIn, same goes for Twitter, same goes for finding anyone's address. I mean, you can find out way too much personal information online, but that just helps you get a hold of anyone you ever need to get a hold of. And you can't be afraid to put yourself out there. You gotta go for it. I've never been afraid to do that. And now it may have been because I was young. It may have been because I was naive. It may have been because I, you know, had the confidence. But whatever those combination of things is, you've gotta go for it. And like I talk about in the first chapter, put yourself out there. The second chapter is when you're actually starting your business, and this is so important, you've gotta start small. So many people, and I was giving a lecture to 400 entrepreneurs a few months ago, and one of them raised their hand and said, I can't start my business right now because I need $25,000 to start it, and you know, I can't get a loan from a bank right now because banks aren't lending. And I said, well, back up a second, you know, why do you need $25,000 to start it? What kind of business are you in? And she said, well, I want to start a hair salon. And I said, okay, what's the $25,000 for? And she went on and to explain that she needs this for her, you know, her lease, and she needs this for, you know, her monthly overhead expense, and she's gonna have a few other people that work in it with her, so they'll pay her rent for their stalls, and you know, she has it all figured out. And then she says, well, $15,000 of that is for the franchise fee. And I said, franchise fee, what are you doing? And she's like, well, there's this hair cutting place I saw in a magazine, and if I do their franchise, then they'll help me. And I said, okay, well, back up a second. Have you calculated how many heads you have to cut to make back that $15,000? You know, if you're doing $30 haircuts, and if your costs are $15 per haircut, you know, quick math, $15 profit, $15,000, you gotta cut 1,000 people's hair before you even pay for that franchise fee. Why don't you just ditch the franchise fee, start your small business with $10,000, get the smallest office space you can get for as little amount of money, and then grow over time. And then by then, you won't even need the franchise, you know, because it'll be Cameron's Hair Salon, and you've already built your client base. And it's all about the way you break down the problem. You've got to attack the problem, you got to break it down into small chunks, and you've got to get creative. I mean, one of the best things about the banks not lending right now is that it forces you to be creative. You know, if you could go out and get a $250,000 loan to go and start your business and you come up with this brilliant ad campaign and everything else, well, it might not work. And it would be much better to start with a fraction of that and to test it and to know what works and know what doesn't and then do more of what works. One of my favorite chapters in the book is after you've started your business and you started small and you're doing well and you're making money is you've got to adapt. You've got to adapt to your competitors, and you've got to adapt to your competition. And if you don't adapt, the chapter is called Adapt or Die. And if you don't adapt, then your business will die. And you know, we've seen that with a lot of companies, you know, whether it be banks or automakers or anyone else that have gotten bailout money, is because they didn't continue to adapt. So back to my story, when I was a junior in high school, I was working at my father's dealership. I'm now involved in the internet sales. So many people, when they go to buy a car, they start online. Well, I was, you know, people might send in an inquiry saying, hi, I'm interested in an Explorer or, you know, whatever kind of vehicle. And then I said to myself, all right, we've got 3,000 people coming to our website every month, but only like a couple dozen actually email us. How can we get more of their contact information? Because if we get more of their contact information, we already know that they are coming to our website for a reason. If we can get more of their contact information, then we can call them, we can set up an appointment, we can get them in, we can show them the vehicle that they want, and then hopefully we can sell them the vehicle. So I created an idea that when you came onto our website and you closed out your browser, this pop-up certificate would come up on your computer and it would say, hey, wait, thanks for visiting Magic City Ford. Please enter your name, email, and phone number, and you can print this certificate and you can save $100 on a whatever kind of car you want. So instantly, instead of getting a couple dozen leads a month, we're now getting over 100 leads a month. Now what that means is that over 100 leads, if we are closing, let's say, you know, 10 or 15% of those at an average, let's just say $1,000 profit, 15 extra sales at $1,000 profit is an extra $15,000 a month. That's a lot of money. So $15,000 extra per month only because of this little dumb pop-up coupon. So what went off in my head when I did that was I should sell this to every dealership in the country. You know, why don't I sell this coupon? It works so well for our dealership, and we're just in Roanoke, Virginia. Think about how well it would work in major cities. And so now what I did was I created that as a business. And I took that little coupon, and I said, well, how much can I charge for it? Well, it's pretty simple. I'm not going to be able to charge that much. So I charged $199, and I immediately went out, and I got a newspaper story in Automotive News, which is a trade journal that every dealership reads. So I knew that it was targeted. I mean, I could have paid for an advertisement, but people trust a story, and you have instant credibility. So why would I want to pay for, you know, a small corner ad when I can get a full-page story, and it's free? So I got a story in Automotive News, and it highlighted all the success our dealership had with this little pop-up coupon. Immediately, my phone's ringing off the hook. Every dealership in the country wants this pop-up coupon. So after just a few months' time, I signed up 200 dealerships that were paying me $200 a month, and my overhead expense was only a couple $100s and whatever the postage was to mail them a bill. But I had 200 dealerships paying me $200 a month. I was making $40,000 a month as a junior in high school with that simple, dumb idea. And I think, you know, in order to sell something, you've got to be able to explain it, and you've got to make it very, very simple. So I'm always looking for opportunity. I'm always looking in ways to do things very simple. I want to keep it simple, and I want to, you know, start a business and grow it. And I ran that business for a year and a half, and I sold it. I went off to college at Virginia Tech. I came back to my dorm room one day, and in my wallet, I had all these gift cards. Does anyone in the room have a gift card that you have not spent? It could be at your house, in your wallet, anything. Like, okay, that's like over 65% probably. Have a gift card that they have not spent. And what I did was I created the first marketplace for that on the internet. So if you've got $100 to Foot Locker, and let's say you just bought a new pair of shoes, and you'd rather have cash, you come on to our website, you list it for sale at $90. You're happy to get $90 cash, and this guy over here is happy to get $90 value at Foot Locker, $100 value for 90 bucks. We just connect buyers and sellers. So it was eBay for gift cards. As I started doing research, gift card industry is an $80 billion a year industry, which is sort of just fascinating in itself because that means we take $80 billion of our U.S. currency and we basically buy it in a gift card and we give it to someone, which means we're floating all these stores' cash flow by giving them $80 billion of our money. And it's even worse if we're putting a gift card on a credit card because then we're paying interest. It's just, you see where I'm going with this. So anyhow, I create CertificateSwap.com. It was the internet's first marketplace for gift cards. I took a semester off from college. I went out and raised venture capital. I raised $10 million in venture capital to grow and expand the company. However, the contingencies on that were I was going to have to move to where the venture capitalist was based. I was going to have to give up college for 4 years. I was going to have to sign a management contract. I was going to have to agree to a salary that was less than what I made when I was 12. That really excited me. And then I was going to have to give up majority ownership in my company. So essentially, instead of being an entrepreneur, which is what I am at heart, I'm now going to be an employee. And sure, I'll own a small percentage of this company, and maybe we'll grow it into a $100 million company, maybe we'll grow it into more than that, and then I would have still my small ownership. But the problem was that I would be the CEO, but I wouldn't be calling the shots. And that's my reputation on the line. And just like when we walked away from the offer that we could have sold a company for more earlier, my reputation is very important to me. So I decided, my partner and we sold the company instead. Unfortunately for a lot less. But we sold the company, and we still made a really nice return. And from start to finish, from the company's launch date, we had raised money, we had turned down the offer, and we had sold the company in less than 6 months. So it was a very quick return on investment. After I left college, I went and I ran my father's Ford dealership. I ran the sales departments. We grew about 180-some% year over year. It was one of the fastest growing Ford dealers sales-wise in the entire country. So I then became, I was then invited to the Ford family reunion. And this was 4 years ago now. So the Ford family, Edsel Ford, calls me on my cell phone and he said, "Cameron, what have you done that you guys are selling so many cars?" And I said, "Well, I just changed the entire way we do business. You know, our entire focus is on the customer. Our entire focus is on making the process easy. And all we do is take them from start to finish and we make it very easy for them and we explain everything and we just treat them right." And not that we hadn't been doing that before. We'd been in business 70 years. We were doing it fine. But we just changed a few things. We cut some expenses and we increased sales and we sold 800 extra cars. We did $10 million extra in revenue and sales. And we increased our profits by more than $1 million. And I was just a 20-year-old kid and, you know, didn't necessarily know that much about the car business, but it's just the way that you look at the problem and the way you came up with the ideas. So after that, I went and I wrote a book. Of course, it's called You Call the Shots. Oprah saw the book. She invited me to do her primetime TV show, The Big Give. And The Big Give was all is like Extreme Home Makeover. I got to travel the country helping people in need. One of my favorite episodes was I was in New York City and I was helping a guy by the name of Mike Machinsky. He was 33 years old. He had been diagnosed with advanced Hodgkin's lymphoma. He had been given 6 months to live. His wife was 31 and she had already beaten breast cancer. His biggest fear is that he's going to die and his three daughters are not only going to lose their dad, but they're also going to lose their house because they're not going to have any money to pay for the mortgage. So my challenge was to pay off the mortgage in basically 72 hours and I couldn't use any of my own money. I couldn't use any of my contacts. I had to actually go out and talk about pressure, you know, in a city where I don't know necessarily anyone. And even if I did, I couldn't use my contacts. So the first thing I did was I called the mortgage company and I got the CEO on the line and I negotiated down the balance of the mortgage from $210,000. I got him to discount it $75,000 if I could raise the balance. And the way I explained it to him was, "Hey, listen, if I don't have this thing paid off in 72 hours, you're going to be foreclosing on it and you're going to take a beating that way. So why don't you work with me? Let's do this. Let's help this family." And I got everything together. And ultimately, I was able to pay off the mortgage and ended up having money left over for scholarships for his three daughters and all those things. So, you know, now I spend the majority of my time helping people. And I graduated from a public high school. Our graduation rate was only 63%. So I've seen firsthand the struggles in high schools across America. And 7,000 students every day in the U.S. drop out of high school. Every single day, 7,000 kids drop out of high school. So it's very, very, very simple. We can either educate now, and education is the most important thing you can give anyone. My dad said, you know, when I was a kid, you can lose all your money, your house, your wife, your car. Education is something that can never be taken away from you. So I'm a big proponent in education, and I'm very, very, very involved in a national organization called Jobs for America's Graduates, and our only focus is targeting those 7,000 kids that drop out per day and keeping them in school. And the number one reason why people drop out is because they don't think they are going to have the grades to go to college or the money, and they don't think that they have any other alternative. So what we do is we help get their grades up so that they can go to college, either on a scholarship or whatever else, or we get them on-the-job training and a high school diploma so that they can enter the workforce and be a productive citizen. So that's primarily what I focus on today. And of course, I sold my last business, which was Certificate Swap. I sold it 5 years ago. I did the Oprah show. I host a show in London. I lived in LA for a year and a half doing other TV projects. But my biggest passion is young people. And I was so honored to be able to be invited here today. And thank you so much, Mr. Simpkins, for making this possible. And now I'd love to take questions or what's next?
Indeed, yes.
Great. Thank you all so much. Thank you. Thank you.
Want a bottle of water? All right, if you have a question, we'll try to get it answered for you in the time frame we have. And I did receive a couple early on, so I'd like to ask on behalf of those that turned these in, how did your little sister react when you gave her such a small share? Are you guys still talking?
Yeah, my sister's 19 now and in college, and I've paid her back the $900, so we're good. And then she was so smart as to ask for interest. So I paid her $900 plus interest, so I don't feel bad anymore. Oh, not to say I felt bad in the first place. We made a deal. But nevertheless, I paid her back.
What was the most fun company that you ever created?
The most fun company? Well, all my internet companies were fun. And for me, the most fun company was the one I was doing right now. So when the company was not fun, that's when I looked to sell it or to get rid of it or to do close it, whatever. So if I wasn't excited about it, then I wouldn't do it. And that's probably why I had so many. It was that every year I was almost getting involved in something different.
So all these potential entrepreneurs sitting out here need to make sure that whatever they do, they like it, they have a passion for it.
Yes, if you don't have a passion for it, it doesn't matter. You've got to have a passion for it or you will not be successful.
We have a question. What's your next creativity project?
The next project that I have a book that I'm working on that'll come out next year, probably summer.
Did you say economics?
Did I study?
I teach economics. I just wondered.
Well, we haven't quite narrowed the exact focus down, but and then another project I have is creating a web-based platform for every TV, newspaper, and radio affiliate in the country. So right now there's no common platform or common language that they're all written on, so we're looking at leveling that playing field.
You know, this question kind of hits home to me. Sometimes people are afraid of failure, and as successful as you are, have you ever had some real disappointments and failures?
Sure. I think several of my businesses may be looked at from the outside as successful because they simply made a profit. However, to me, I had much higher expectations myself, and if they fell short of those goals, then one, I'm not going to be excited about the company anymore. And there were a couple instances where other people might say the company was successful, but for me, it was a complete and utter failure because I thought it was going to be 100 times bigger than what it was. And it was either because of timing, it was either because of the idea, it was either because of the competition or the market. But you could look at it and say, and I think it's all in how you look at it, obviously. But for me, if it's not 100% successful, then I'm not interested in doing it. And I'm not excited about doing it 110%, then I'm not going to do it. So I've definitely had my failures. I've definitely tried to learn from all of them. I think, there's nothing wrong with having a failure as long as you learn from it and don't continue to do the same thing over and over.
I'm reminded of a story of Sam Walton. And they told Sam Walton, please, don't try this, because if you go in a retail business against Woolworth, against Montgomery Ward, against Sears, you're going to fail. And so what would you advise our potential entrepreneurs about standing your ground?
Well, when you're passionate about something and when you've done all the research you possibly can, and that's the most important is, I took plenty of risks along the way, but I always took calculated risks. And being young is the best time you can take those risks because you're less likely to have all of the responsibilities that you're going to have when you're older. So whether that be a mortgage, whether that be a car payment, whether that be other expenses, now is the time, and there's never been a better time. And you may say, well, the economy sucks. Well, the economy, whether that's good or bad, but even better, if you can make it when the economy sucks, then you're going to be that much better off when the economy gets better, and it certainly will. So the whole thing is starting small and managing your expenses and just getting started.
We have a question here from Lena Montgomery of Brevard Workforce. Thank you, Lena. She wants to say thank you for coming. The Brevard area will lose in 2010 over 7,100 jobs in the space industry. Will have a domino effect in which many others and possibly 20,000 job losses in this area. What advice can you give the audience, especially the young people, on their future when jobs won't be what they were for their parents?
Well, I think that's, I think our generation is already seeing that firsthand. I mean, the average number of jobs that someone our age has is 7 to 11 over the course of our lifetime. So whereas our parents' generation might graduate college and go and they work for a company and they stay with that company their entire career, our generation is already by default much more entrepreneurial in that we're always thinking of the next thing. And I'm going to go work for this company for a couple years, I'm going to go work for this company. And instead of the ladder being straight up at the same company, we're zigzagging and we're also spreading out our experience. So, I mean, in the last 2 years, there have been over 6 million people that have lost their job in America. So that's 6 million less taxpayers. That's 6 million, less people that have income coming in, and they're now dependent on whatever they can get. So, it's a problem that's hitting people everywhere. I think the internet is great because it's leveled that playing field. So if you lose a job, you might not have to just get up and move right away, which is what used to take place. So I think there's a lot of opportunity out there, And you know, it's definitely it's a bad time.
Two quick final questions, and then you can ask your question. He'll be out in the lobby for a little while signing books. One, I love this one. Have you made Donald Trump nervous?
I don't know about that. I saw him last week, and I don't think that I made him nervous. He's
and
a
super finally,
nice guy, though. The TV show is for TV. He's a super nice guy.
And finally, how does God fit in your plans?
Well, I started tithing the church when I was 9 years old, and I've always, you know, been taught that you give back to your community and your church. And you know, I was involved in mission trips and youth groups and everything throughout high school, and volunteering in inner city, and the same way through what I did with the Big Give and the charities I support. So, I mean, yeah, I was raised in an Episcopal church, and I think that's very important.
Excellent. Thank you. I'd like at this time to invite Mr. Simpkins back to the podium for a couple of closing remarks. Cameron
Thank you.
Johnson.
I want to thank you again for coming out today. Great speech, great. We have these twice a year, in the spring and the fall, and we always invite open and to the public. You know, we are prone to accept what's around us and just think it was always there. Well, the decorations, or this stage decoration, was not always here. It's new, I'm proud of it. The group from the college here, the arts department, has selected this and changed the entire thing. But you didn't know that. You didn't even recognize it, did you? So the decorations here, I want to express my appreciation. Our committee thought it up. My daughter had something to do with it. Our committee thought it up that the stage needed to have some good decorations. And the art department here at the college did it. And thank you, art department. Thank you, Jim Drake. And thank you for letting us do this twice a year. Thank you for coming.
We have a very, very exciting speaker for you in the fall. We'll see you in November. Greet Cameron in the lobby.